This is the first of two videos on change of basis matrices. In this video, we're going to go over the general theory of change of basis matrices. What are they? What do they do? Then, in the second video, I'm going to give you the formula for the change of basis matrix, and we're going to work some examples. So, everything we've done so far is really a tower. Everything, all of linear algebra rests on a foundation, which is row reduction. Now, row reduction and putting things in reduced row echelon form is the way that you solve systems of linear equations. If somebody gives you a problem saying AX equals B, you set up the matrix, you row reduce it, you read off the answer. Great. But it's not all that often that somebody just hands you a problem of AX plus B, AX equals B. Instead, we're often talking about properties of different vectors in Rm. So if somebody gives you n vectors in Rm, the game is always to package them into a matrix. If somebody asks, are those vectors linearly independent? That's the same as saying, is there a unique solution to AX equals 0? If somebody says, do they span Rm? Well, that's the same thing as saying, is there a solution to AX equals B for every B? So by row reducing this matrix, you learn an awful lot about these vectors. Well, that's great if you've got vectors in Rm, but what if you have vectors in some other vector space, some abstract vector space, a space of polynomials, for example? Well, then you need to use coordinates. If you pick a basis for V, then to every vector you can associate a column of numbers, the coordinates of that vector in the basis B. And that's great. Then you can use everything you learned about collections of vectors in Rm and apply it to collections of vectors in V. The last step that we're going to do is flexibility. We want to be able to use different bases, because sometimes one basis is good for one application, a different basis is good for another application, and you need to be able to switch back and forth. So a change of basis matrix is all about changing coordinates from one basis to another. So here's the deal. Let's suppose that we have a vector space V, and we've got a vector little v in that big vector space. And let's suppose we've got two bases, the B basis and the D basis. The big question is, how were the coordinates in the B basis and the coordinates in the D basis related? So we've got these two operations. We have the operation of take coordinates in the B basis and take coordinates in the D basis. We'd like to have a way of converting from the B basis to the D basis and a way of converting from the D basis to the B basis. And it turns out that there's a matrix that does that. PDB converts from the B basis to the D basis, and there's a matrix PBD that converts from the D basis to the B basis. In other words, if you take the coordinates of something in the B basis and multiply by PDB, you get the coordinates in the D basis. If you start with the coordinates in the D basis and multiply by PBD, you get the coordinates in the B basis. Now notice that you read right to left. The B basis, PDB converts from the B basis to the D basis. PDB converts from the D basis to the B basis. Another way to notice it is that this B lines up here, this D lines up there. Now, since these matrices do the opposite of each other, one undoes what the other does, those matrices have to be inverses of one another. Finally, if you have three bases and you want to convert from B to D, you could first convert from B to C and then convert from C to D. So this is the rule for how you compose change of basis matrices, and this is the rule for how you take inverses of change of basis matrices. Okay, that's what change of basis matrices are. They're the things that allow you to ride the elevator, to go from one coordinate system to the other. In the next video, we'll talk about how to actually find this magic matrix and what to do with it.